Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining today's webinar with us. Other than that, I want to just check on everyone. I hope everyone is safe at home, and this is the best way to connect with everyone in this situation of crisis. Also, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Anshu. I head the LLM admissions at Jindal. And today we have Mrs. Maulika Arabi with us as a presenter for today's lecture. I would like to introduce her with all of you. She is an advisor with the Center for Environment Law at WWF India. She has also been working on a lot of legal aspects of environmental regulations and natural resource and public policy issues. She's also been a visiting faculty to one of the lot of prestigious universities across India. So today we are very glad to welcome you on board, ma'am. I would like you to take over the platform and start with why study environment law, climate and energy, and talk to people. Also, I would want to inform all the attendees that after the session, we will be taking question answers from you, whatever doubts you have about the course or anything you want to ask, ma'am. And we will also, I'll be moderating the session and I'll take all the queries. Thank you. Ma'am, over to you.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. It would have been great if we could have seen you, but I guess, you know, I mean, looking at one not a little over 100 people on the same screen is a little difficult, though for over a month we have been living in these boxes within, you know, when at least 15, 20 people on various Zoom calls and team calls and webinars. But thanks a lot to everyone for joining. This is, in fact, overwhelming because, you know, when we were planning for this webinar, one of the biggest challenge in front of us was to speak about something which an LLM program which we are offering, and to also engage with you all for the most prominent subject in today's times. You know, everyone is talking about how environment is improving, how you know, the wildlife is reclaiming literally what used to be its habitat, and flamingos. You know, I mean, there is one Navi Mumbai video which almost everyone has seen, where the flamingos have made, and more than any year, this year there are lots of birds which are coming onto many of the wetlands and the creeks and all. So it's definitely a wow moment for many, but going forward, you know, this is not the usual time. The reason why we see them is because we are going through the most unprecedented times due to the COVID-19, due to a virus which, obviously, you know, it's the reason why such a virus is taking and spreading throughout the world is because of the ecological damage, and it is definitely linked to the biodiversity loss in various things, or say that we not able to understand how well to manage what nature has given us, and in Britain, most likely, you know, such viruses are just increasing by we don't even know. This is the name of one such virus. Similarly, the scientific community might be knowing few more viruses, but then There is a lot which is happening, and then we all are privy to these instances. And to see such a number of people who are, you know, currently listening, I would just say that A, you have already made a presence felt. That is, by deciding to even understand what environmental loss is, or why climate change is so important, and why this course which we are offering, which is a master's in law program, your understanding and your presence here clearly shows that you definitely want to make the difference, and you do not want anything to be as conventional as it used to be. So this opportunity, you know, this lockdown is definitely an opportunity for all of us to revisit our own practices, to revisit our own, you know, the ideas, the theories which we have in mind, whether it's the same thing, and can we propose something else to the government as an organization, institutions. I'm sure there are a lot of lawyers. I mean, everyone here, 50% of you might be lawyers. So So how you can make actually the difference which is much needed in understanding and interpreting the law and the policies. And you know, the actual meaning of sustainability is that this is the forum, and you know, such are the courses where one can understand the real meaning and how we can contribute. So you know, this webinar exclusively, as you might have read about it, it's we wanted to speak to you about why an LLM program, or for example, you know, any graduate who wants to do a master's program, why it is important to study environment, say environmental law or an environmental policy, or energy and climate change. And also there are, I would at least list five factors of why it is important. One, we clearly know what government is going through. We definitely want to make a change. We want to see that, you know, most of the multilateral environmental agreements and the conventions which India is party to, whether those conventions are really implemented at a national level in the letter and spirit. If those national laws are really benefiting the countries, you know, be it, say, if I say environmental impact assessment, the first thing which might come to everyone's mind would be that the recent draft, the EIA 2020 is out, and then, you know, the people are supposed to comment on it. And somewhere there is, in one corner, there's an argument going on that you should not, you know, even have such notifications in place. And when the lockdown is there, you should not, you know, continue with certain notifications. Similarly, if you talk about any law, be it a forest related to forests or related to wildlife, related to our biodiversity, or even you know, the specific, the famous, which everyone reads in their even school days, the Environmental Protection Act. The reason why these acts have come into force, and the reason why in various courts, be it Supreme Court, be it High Courts, and be it the National Green Tribunal, we see this law, the environmental law, getting evolved almost every week. You know, after the NGT started functioning, I would say that at least, you know, till few years back, and even now for that matter, the number of judgments which came out from the National Green Tribunal were almost the number of cases would definitely lead you to a law, a change in a law or a policy. Because of those orders and because of those judgments, the environment definitely saw some of the changes which definitely are welcoming. And in some cases, yes, they do leave us, you know, with few of disappointment. But then there is always, you know, in case if you learn about environmental laws, in case if you learn about the upcoming areas like energy and also the climate change, what definitely can happen is, you can be that change maker. In case if we know what are the laws and how well we should be interpreting it, more than that, if we know what our rights and duties are, then we can definitely make a difference. And having studying such an LLM, you know, first thing, where we collaborated with OP Jindal Global University, and we launched this LLM in environmental law, energy and climate change, with two objectives. One was that we wanted to reach out and to increase the cadre of environmental lawyers. If you look at it, I mean, most of those who know how this field functions, we hardly have a handful of environmental lawyers. We don't really have lawyers who have dedicated their, I won't use the word life, but dedicated their practice to exclusively environmental law. And it is important that we have more and more environmental laws, because the cause to fight for an environment is huge. So, you know, that becomes our second reason of why studying this subject becomes more important. The reason why we thought of climate change and energy to be those thematic areas which we should be offering the LLM program in, is because, you know, energy law is something which just is not to me, but to many people, you know, to many working professionals in the environment sector, energy law is seen as an upcoming area. And I would say up and coming area, because in case if you know a lawyer who trains himself to be an energy law expert, the future belongs to that person, for the reason that, you know, at least for 1,000 years or so, the energy law will stay, provided we don't spoil our biodiversity, we continue to use the natural resources sustainably. So that is, you know, that's the reason why energy law is one very important integral part of this LLM, which we felt that should be there. And we should talk about the opportunities which the energy sector can actually create for lawyers, not in just understanding the technicalities of this subject, but how well can we even have more and more policies or more and more you know, regulations which can be put in place within the energy sector. Climate change, I need not say much about this. Everyone talks about it. Everyone knows about it. I guess that everyone interprets it in a very different manner. I guess, you know, some of you might all be knowing that we don't have, within India at least, we don't have anything to call a climate change law. We do not follow a specific litigation, a specific legislation, for example, for understanding the climate change problems. So it is all the more important that, you know, going forward, we should be in a position to, or say, advocate for having a climate change law in place. So to integrate all these three courses into one itself was the biggest challenge for us. And the reason why we did it was that we did a survey before we started, and you know, we launched this program. Like WWF India and the Center for Environmental Law has a wide experience of running few programs in collaboration with National Law University Delhi, and as that experience and taking the survey and speaking to some of the lawyers, we understood that it is very important to offer a course which just not speaks about environmental law, say that is international environmental law, national environmental laws, but also something which talks about climate adaptation, the policies within the climate adaptation. What are those, how well can you interpret the international conventions, and how should you be looking at climate solutions to the climate change problems within your country, and how can law help you, as and how law can be that tool which can have effective answers. Then energy, of course, is one sector. In case if someone is studying climate change, and if you do not study energy law and its aspects, you will be missing out on a major component. So which is why we felt that we should integrate all these three subjects into one course. And that's when we decided to launch this LLM in environmental law, energy and climate change. Last year, the first batch has started with very promising students. I'm sure, you know, many of them might be on this webinar as well. So it's very, you know, the way the courses are designed within this program are, we have academicians teaching the course. We also have conservationists and environmentalists teaching these courses, some of the courses. We also have energy experts teaching the courses, and we have climate change, global warming, and climate adaptation experts. So the reason why I use these three words, because for everyone, you know, global warming is slightly different from, say, climate change. And I'm, of course, I'm a lawyer myself, so I don't want to get into the science of how to define each one of this. But when you come to the legal and a policy space, the way we look at is that in case of the climate change is happening, and we are that crowd who realize, and we do not deny climate change. So because we have accepted climate change, we are trying to find solutions. And we want everyone who are part of these programs, either as a participant or as those who are teaching in this LLM program, they understand that we are facing there is a huge challenge before us. How can we find solutions for these various concepts which we are teaching to a class who are coming to understand, and who are here to learn, one, also get a master's degree, but also most importantly to learn the concepts of these three various subjects which we are offering within the LLM, environmental law, energy and climate change. So yes, of course, you know, I mean, we will be open to as many questions as possible. You can ask us about, you know, any concept or any specific item which you would like to know from us. And through the discussions, through the questions, which I would like Anshu to open for now, and we can take questions, and then by answering, we will give you more information about this course and also about any subject specifically if you want to ask in terms of, say, curriculum or in terms of, you know, our guest faculties, our expert faculties, anyone. Anshu?
Hello. Hello, ma'am. Yeah. So that was beautiful, and that was amazing how you guided us through our LLM program, and also how you told the audience about the changing aspect of environment law. And suddenly we all have started appreciating everything around us in this situation of crisis. So here I can see there's a question that has been, I think it is important for a lot of students who are thinking of an LLM program in environment law, and specifically with us. So the person named Zikra, she is asking that what is the scope of environment law specifically when it comes to LLM course? And also, like, if the person wants to pursue an academic career, how will this LLM program help her, you know, pursue this better and further? So I think this would this question would be useful for a lot of students who would want to know this.
Who's the one who's asked?
Zikra Jabin. Yeah.
Okay. Hi. Sorry, I didn't get exactly your complete name, but thank you for asking this question. And because, you know, you're the first one to ask the question, you get a clap from us. Other than that, see, this program is definitely going to benefit you in academics. How? Once you do an integrated program like this, which is, like I said, you know, which just also will teach you about not just environmental law, but the concepts of climate and energy law. After that, you can either go for your PhD in any of the specific subjects which you, you know, which interests you the most. Even if not for a doctoral studies, but if you want to get into academics, the research concepts through this LLM program, because we do have core courses like, you know, legal research methodologies, seminar writing, and there are these mandatory courses within LLM program, which are designed in such a manner that they are also environmental centric. So it's not that, you know, within legal research methodology, for example, we do not end up teaching, you know, the concepts of how the research is done. But that research also, we show how you need to do research within the environment field. And so these courses, and also something like comparative public law, you know, which is also one of the core courses we teach. Then there is graduate academic seminar writing. In these courses, in case if you want to become an academician and if your inclination is towards that, this LLM program, along with your interactions with the professors who teach you, will give you a lot of you know, space for you to develop, and you can then choose which is that subject which you would like to choose you know, to teach in future. And also, I mean, obviously, you know, in case if you're looking at becoming an academician somewhere, other than the NET qualifying exams and other things, but then there are certain universities now who are offering these courses also like to have, you know, people with an exclusive knowledge of these subjects. And the demand for those who can teach energy law or climate policy is increasing. We ourselves get a lot of requests. So you can, and academics is a very good option after finishing the LLM program. And in case if you're planning to do that, you're on a right path, and you should definitely be planning to do and take up this LLM program. Anshu?
Yeah, I hope this answer from ma'am, like this was an answer to a lot of people who had any confusion about the program. So I'm glad that a lot of interesting questions are coming up with us. And ma'am, there is this person named Ragya who is already a PhD student at NLSIU. And she's asking that she has worked on a lot of energy law per se, and she's it is highly integrated with various various scientific subjects in public policy. And she asked that how do you propose to address this challenge in the new course?
So, you know, when it comes to energy law, I guess, you know, each, those who have designed the syllabus, like, you know, for us in this case, we, and those who become, those who are already into the field of energy, the way and what we try to do is we get the best of the experts within the field of energy to come and interact to the students. Now, in terms of, you know, how we can really have this going further and how we can address the problems of, you know, the current situation is to the best way is to adapt to it. You know, the solutions which we try to do it is as part of not only this LLM program, but also the experts who come and teach these programs. What we try to do is we try developing certain dialogues, and also we interact with a lot of, you know, organizations who are working in the energy sector, and also corporates who are, say, into either are into solar energy or they are into certain other aspects dealing with energy. We have a tie-up with them, including the financial institutions. And then, you know, the as I said, the best way is to adapt to it. And so by adapting to it, we also try and find solutions to many of these concepts. And if you ask us for LLM, like, you know, we are not the ones who have made up our mind that this is what the syllabus is going to be and we are not going to change. We have never said that. And the thing and the most important aspect which one should look forward in this LLM program, which we are offering in collaboration with WWF India is offering in collaboration with JGU, is that we are going to change the syllabus depending upon the changing scenarios around us. Like, for example, if we do not have in the next, you know, the second batch, which we will have for LLM, if we do not have lectures by experts to understand how the energy demand might grow or fall, or should the conventional methods of usage of energy is the right way forward, you know, so it, definitely it's not. So we are going to include many such topics and the changing scenarios, and there will be a comparison between what how the energy demand grew and how the energy demand has not been met, or how better can we be, you know, innovating in the energy sector. So we will be incorporating these things, and of course we'll have to find solutions, otherwise there are a lot of players who will surpass us.
Thank you, ma'am, for answering this. Now, there's this amazing question from Mr. Gangadhar. He says that our present climate change policies mostly ignore the traditional knowledge based on adaptations to climate change. And then he wants you to answer that how do we address this issue for the co-management of traditional knowledge with scientific knowledge?
Yes, very, very important question. I would say, Mr. Gangadharan, thank you for asking that. The traditional knowledge, if you look at law, customary law is a very important concept. And in case if we do not give value and if we do not understand the customary laws, we cannot really proceed with the legislations which are currently coming into force. Similarly, in case if the traditional knowledge is not given importance, say for example, like you asked, you know, the climate adaptation, the best person who would speak and who would talk about his or her island getting submerged, or in case if, you know, if you ask a farmer, for example, he will tell you exactly when to expect the rainfall. And he or she will definitely be more accurate than the meteorological department. So it is the traditional knowledge from small concepts to the larger concepts plays a very important role, and which is why within this LLM program, we actually, though we call our subject, you know, the subject which we, the one of the specialized courses which we are offering, though it is called, it is for climate change, but we designed it in a way and we call that course as adaptation to climate change. And within that, traditional knowledge is one of the concepts which we are teaching within our LLM program as well. Because we do acknowledge that without traditional knowledge, there is no win-win going forward, and it is an important, definitely plays an important role.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. So we have a question from Meghna Shetty. She said, what are the job opportunities there for an LLM graduate besides just being a practicing lawyer or an academician? What is like the job opportunities when she has a LLM degree in environment law?
Right. You know, we were expecting this question to come and we are glad it came. In case if you have completed an LLM program already in, say, environmental law or, you know, any of the related fields, it's just not practice. Litigation is only, say, the only one career path which you can choose. But the other career path which you can choose is within the energy sphere. Like, there are a lot of organizations who are working on climate change and energy concepts. You can, and they need lawyers. They need lawyers to make the scientists understand what are the legal concepts and how well to interpret it. Then there are a lot of places. Like, for example, when you talk about energy, I mean, I'm not talking about the law firms, but there are a lot of organizations who now have exclusive programs which looks at climate change and energy. So these are certain, working with NGOs, working with international non-governmental organizations, and also working with any of the law firms who have an exclusive research area, who research on the climate change and energy aspect. That is one. And some of you might not know that even government is opening up a lot of job offers with government these days within the energy sector. Within various ministries, there is a need for energy experts and climate change experts. So government jobs and working with the government, not just India, but if you have if you have a subject orientation towards any of the international laws, the subject which is applicable globally, you can also go to other countries and can apply for any positions which are open there. So there is a wide opening within this sector, and you will have to just choose the right one, which is the one which you would like to, and where you feel whatever from your studies, whichever area suits you the best, you should be in a position to apply jobs in that sector.
Thank you, ma'am. So we have a next question from Deeksha, who says that a lot of universities abroad are offering courses related to environment law, energy and climate change, and which also has an element of international arbitration, which she says that attracts a lot of international law firms dealing in environment law. And then she also asks that whether we at this program, offering this program, does have this kind of a course structure, and also that how competitive is this program when compared to an LLM in energy environment change offered in countries like US?
Mm-hmm. Right. So thanks, Diksha, for that question. So, you know, when it comes to arbitration, as a lawyer, if you look at arbitration, everyone knows that it comes in at a time when there is a dispute settlement. Arbitrations do happen when there is an acknowledgement that there might be a dispute, or there could be a difference of opinion between two parties, and that the arbitrator is trying to settle these concepts. And within environment, if you look at it, most of the times those who are spoiling the environment or damaging the environment vis-a-vis those who are not damaging and pro-environment, There is definitely here the one advocating for nature is slightly on a very different footage. So when it comes to exclusively teaching the arbitration within the LLM program as part of the syllabus, it is not named as an exclusive course, but arbitration is something we do talk about. In terms of for example, those lawyers and practicing advocates who come to take the classes, they do speak about how arbitration. being talked about. So that is as part of as part of the arbitration. In terms of how we are how this LLM program is going to compete, I don't think compete is the right word, but then the in case if you would go to US and do this LLM, such LLM programs offered in that country, obviously, anyone who have designed such a unique program will have the niche in the mind, will think about the current times and design the course. But in India, all the more, the reason why we need to have such courses is because the demands in developing country for such a field and to master in such a field is more than in those countries. And in case if someone from India would want to go to US to do an LLM, we would say that, just sit back, look at the curriculum which is being offered here. And in case if you, as part of this course, we have one exclusive course which is designed around implementation of environmental laws, and we take people to the field. So it's a study tour. Like for this year, the first batch, we were supposed to take the students to Sundarbans. The Sundarbans, which is, everyone knows it to be a beautiful mangroves and the sea and the estuaries. But the best part is you should be going to places where you can actually evidence the climate change. So the field visits, not just one, but many field visits to these protected areas, to national parks, to tiger, to the tiger reserve, and to various places where you can actually see on ground situation is what we are offering. So in case if you want to have a practical experience, I guess you should be choosing the one LLM program which is being offered by JGU and WWF India.
Thank you, ma'am, for answering her question. So this again is an interesting question, which is put up by Dr. Tripti, and she says that you just mentioned in the in the lecture that we don't have any specific laws related to climate change, in spite having so many issues of climate change in India. And then she is also putting up a question that how is it possible for us to solve this kind of climate issues?
Right. So Tripti, right? Sorry if the name is wrong, but the reason why there's a smaller community, I would say more consisting of the younger lot these days, who are advocating and asking that we should have an exclusive climate litigation. Now there are a lot of people but there are a lot of people who are saying that India as such has many legislations, environment related, in place, and by having a new law, what difference are we going to make? So within this argument, what the bigger argument which everyone is not able to understand is to have, because we are facing and climate change, or adapting to the climate change is becoming the most important aspect for any, be it a scientist or be it even a lawyer, for anyone who understands climate change, this is growingly becoming a concern. So having said that, we are advocating for a law. We want a legislation to come in place. And how we can solve the already existing problems, I would say the fight is immense. If we are trying to, whenever there is, as of now, if you ask me, there is in India, slowly people are talking about climate litigation, which in abroad has already started. You talk about US, you talk about Australia, Germany. There are already cases in the court which qualify as climate litigation. But in India, we still do not have any such cases because we do not have a climate law to court and to file cases. But in case if tomorrow if such a such an act comes, which is definitely going to come, because there is a lot of push from not just those who are working in this sector, but also from students and from lawyers. So there is going to be a law, and then I think things will get formalized. As of now, we do our battling, we do are trying to fight by either talking about the basic rights which have been given in the constitution, then we do take out few sections within the within various acts, be it even, you know, Environmental Protection Act, or we talk about principles, the international principles of environmental law, and we try and you know, make the case seem, and also will do talk about the various solutions which are possible under the existing laws. So the fight is there, but yes, it is definitely very soon we need to, and the government has to realize that we need an exclusive act to address many of the growing climate and climate change issues which we are facing. Yes, Anshu.
So ma'am, we have a next question which might be very important for most of the lawyers who is attending this webinar, and this question has been put up by Smita, and she says that our Supreme Court has already given some directives as to introduction of environment education as a compulsory subject at undergrad degree level in all universities. But as we see, it is actually not properly taught, or is it not a grantable subject yet? So she is saying, what should be the role of lawyers in the field of environment to implement this properly?
Okay. So Smita, this is the challenge of having a law and having the law to be implemented. So, you know, having robust laws is definitely a requirement, but having those laws to implement is a further bigger challenge. And in case if, you know, the Supreme Court obviously has said that it has to be part of the syllabus, and like WWF India, our environment education program runs a lot of these, you know, with government schools, those which are called CBSE schools also, and also, you know, many of the private schools within various urban as well as rural, to make them understand that this subject is very important. And in case if it is mandated, all the schools should also take it seriously. But the, you know, the end user is always the student. And in case if the students are aware that this is the subject which is mandated, and that they should definitely be learning about good practices and the sustainable practices to give back to environment, then you know, that is the only way. It is the stakeholder who should ask that this is my right. You know, if there is a directive that. Or not. You know, the answer which I'm giving, for some, it might just seem that maybe this is not practical, but, you know, hey, that's how it is. You can actually implement the law. In case if we say that, is there an audio problem? Okay. Anshu, can you hear me? Because
yes,
on my
ma'am.
Screen it's. Okay.
Yeah, I can. Yeah.
So you know, so as I was saying, so it is not. The end user should obviously be aware of you know, their rights, and they should ask various schools and also the teachers who are hired to teach environmental studies in various schools should not just teach them science, because it's not you know, you're not teaching science, you're not talking. Not that. So the teachers obviously needs to be trained, and there are many organizations and even lawyers, for example, you know, should take it as a responsibility. It's not about that, you know, you should just file another contempt case or something. It's not that. But then how lawyers can help is you should be just watchful of what is happening. In case if you have kids, just make sure that, you know, the school is actually teaching this subject. If you're just someone who just knows certain schools, then speak to the principals and ask them about what are the concepts within the environmental sciences course which are being taught in various schools. So being responsible is not just in saying, you know, each and every one should be understanding this. You can run online campaigns like, you know, give back to nature, give up plastics, is some of the campaigns which WWF is running. Then there is a campaign called Tide Turner campaign, which we are running. So there are a lot of such programs which you need to see that such campaigns can make a huge difference. And you can be part of many such campaigns ongoing, or you can design a new one. Yes, Anshu, can we take
it? So there is this person named James. He just want to know that what are the research organizations we have tie up with in India, so that when he's coming for an LLM degree, whether he's getting some opportunities like that or not.
Yes. Thank you for the question, James. So we do work with, a lot of research organizations. Like, for example, for WWF, if you ask, we obviously are associated with research organizations who are mainly into the wildlife research. But when it comes to the legal aspect, we do work with a lot of partnering organizations who do environmental law research, and they are also, part of certain programs. That is, the projects are also implemented on ground. So to name a few of these research organizations, like, we collaborate with ORF, Observer Research Foundation. We do interact with, CPR. Then we do interact with, recently, for mainly on the environmental law, Vidhi is one of the groups, which is also one of the think tanks. So we do interact with them. There are Trust Legal is one such law firm which is also into research, so we do interact with them. So there are, for different concepts, like for water, there are different groups. For air and related to air pollution and air issues, we do collaborate with fewer organizations. And JGU itself has has collaboration with lot of other universities and lot of think tanks within India and abroad. Whose researchers do come here, and they're part of many many conferences and seminars. Not just that, but they also do produce papers together. So we do have collaborations with research institutes, and yes, and in to doing this course with us, more such avenues will open up.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. So we have another question from Vatsa. She says that what are some of the environment laws that will help in the district court to get remedy for the public as a whole?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So to get a remedy at a district court is a slightly difficult proposition, because many a times what happens is the problem which you, any environmental problem which you are facing, in case if you can represent in the court the damage due to that environmental problem which it is causing to a said community, or in case if it is a said colony, or if you're next to a dumping site, if it is due to the dumping site or the toxic waste near to that colonies, or to various places, you will have to then just look at those sections, only those sections, because district court, as I'm sure if you're a lawyer you would know, that the remedies at a district level are far less than when compared to at the high court level. But at the district level, what is possible is that in case if it is a pollution matter, or in case if it is something directly related to the damages which is caused to the environment, and in case if it is about any violation to the rights which directly imply also environment, you can obviously have, you can apply various remedies within the district court, and can file a smart litigation, I would say, because it completely depends on you. If you want to get a remedy at a district level, then you need to quote the right provisions, because there are not many which can be challenged at that level. So you'll have to choose the right sections of the right laws to do it.
Okay. So I think Diksha again has a very interesting question coming up. So she says that does COVID-19 bring into light the issue of climate migrants and animal rights, taking into consideration the fact that wet markets in Wuhan were majorly employed by those ecological migrants. And also, by those who has been name given by China and also has been witnessed in Africa, that once climate affected the rainfall patterns, further destroying their agriculture, they resorted to destroying biodiversity. Is there any connection in the context to what is happening right now?
So, Diksha, you know, I'm sure it's the mind these days is thinking many things, because there are a lot of articles, you know, which are also floating. See, the concepts of as to what exactly is the problem, I'm sure we clearly know, and the emergence is being quoted as the wet market. But to all these questions, you know, the answer is, in case if there is a damage, in case if you know, if, like, for example, climate change is a driver to biodiversity loss, the changing climate, the patterns, or, you know, the seasonal problems, you know, because of climate change which occur, the environmental problems, or even sometimes the natural disasters which occur, they do have a lot of impact on the ecology. They do have a lot of impact on the biodiversity. We don't just lose our biodiversity, but there are, you know, a lot of times we are not able to come out of these problems. So various, you know, in various countries, like how you've quoted, that whether those problems are all interrelated, I'm sure they are. Or, you know, in case if you ask me as to pin down the exact problem, I might not be. But in my general understanding and from what we know, so basically, you know, we've been actually looking at the illegal wildlife trade and why such a trade in wild animals and wildlife is because, you know, it, the reason why we've been advocating and we're saying that don't indulge in illegal wildlife trade is partly for this reason. In case if you do not have, if you use wild animals for the thing which you're not supposed to use, it is obviously going to pose a threat. There are a lot of viruses which humankind has no answer to. COVID happens to be one such virus. Though there was, you know, there were these one or two articles which came out which just spoke about that it has come from bat, but we do not have exact, you know, a scientific evidence to just pin down to that. We might, again, we don't even want to name a specific country. But everyone knows, you know, in terms of what is happening in each of the country and what measures those countries are taking. But the, you know, the best, I would say not an answer, but this whole argument about whether they are interconnected, yes, they are definitely interconnected, because we do see that there are not just one driver, but there are many drivers which are causing the problem and which are impacting our biodiversity, and due to that there are many more problems which are coming out which humankind do not have solutions to. I hope that answers you.
I hope, Diksha, you got an answer to your question, which it was a really interesting question, because a lot of us has this going inside our mind that who should be held responsible and how. But
but you know, as a lawyer, sorry Anshu to interrupt you, but you know, as a lawyer, in case if you ask me, the first thing which I was looking at is that, is anyone, you know, is any country going to challenge? I mean, can there be a, will people come forward to file a case against a specific country? And you know, there were again one or two, some unfortunately were fake news that certain countries are filing the case on an X country. But then, you know, all of a sudden, if you look at law, you have to actually see this from a human rights angle. There has been a clear violation. There has been a medical negligence. There is the human rights have definitely been affected. So what else do we need? In case if a country can prove that not just prove in what is going around the world through this lockdown, but in case if we can clearly see that there was negligence at some rate, because that has made the whole world to completely shut, and you know, which is why we are interacting through this box. Otherwise, we would have all been face to face now. So yes, I mean there is, and the responsibility should definitely. That's my personal opinion. That in case if there are someone who has been identified as responsible, the law should definitely take its course.
Yeah, and also I think, ma'am, lot of people around the world is also questioning the role of WHO as an, you know, in this situation of crisis, which again is another very you know, critical question to be discussed about. But yeah, so that is what. So now again, we have, so I think a lot of students, a lot of people who are attending this webinar had a question regarding whether this is a diploma course or a degree program. So I would like to just tell everyone that it's a full-time degree program. It's not a diploma course. And there is no online course that we offer for the LLM under this specialization. The courses take place in Delhi. It is a non-residential program because you don't have to stay on campus and pursue this program. So that's the only difference, but it is not a diploma course. And I would also want ma'am to just make people understand the validity of this course, like the recognition, so that.
Yes, I can understand where this question is coming from, because you know WWF runs three very popular diploma, PG diploma programs. But so that might be a little confusing. So the answer is no. This is a master's in law program. The people who are eligible to do this LLM in environmental law, energy and climate change should be lawyers. So your qualification should be LLB for enrolling into the LLM program. And only lawyers are eligible to take up a master's in law program. So this is not a diploma. And for an LLM, the way we designed this course is definitely, it's, you know, like Anshu just said, it's a non-residential program, and there is a whole theory behind why we designed it as a non-residential, because we wanted the working professionals and many who are also, you know, are into various careers or who have just taken up as freshers into, they've just gone into their career, even they can enhance their skills within the subject, and which is why the classes happen over the weekend. So Saturday full day classes, and then we have two sessions which happen on Thursday evening and Friday evening. So the classes happen on Thursday, Friday, Saturday in Delhi. So no, this is not an online program, and the only LLBs, only lawyers are eligible to apply for this master's program.
Thank you, ma'am, for answering this question, because I think a lot of questions, we also had people with M.Tech or a B.Tech background and interest in environment law also want to pursue this LLM, but unfortunately the regulatory bodies does not allow a person without a law degree to pursue an LLM program. So that's the thing. Also, we have this another question coming up from Meghna, who says, after post the lockdown, do you think there will be any change to the environment? If yes, what do you think would be the major changes?
She has actually asked the question which we all are very scared of, you know, because currently, if you look at the WhatsApp university or, you know, the Twitter university, there are so many messages going around. People showing that from Jalandhar, the snow-capped mountains are seen, and you know, they're able to see deer, they're able to see elephants, they're seeing leopards, and a lot of other wildlife. And also the pollution levels, the air pollution has improved. I would use the word drastically, because this is what the media is also saying, that how bad the air quality was. But if you look at after lockdown, the air has improved, the water in Ganges, in Yamuna, where you know, most of the Delhiites and those people who live in the national capital region, they might have seen Yamuna only as black, But these days we see pictures where it is either green or blue, which shows that which definitely shows that the health of the river has improved. Now currently the industries are shut. You know, everything which spoils the environment, which spoils the air, which spoils the water, which also spoils the soil quality, is completely stopped. It's currently in the lockdown. Everything is on a halt, in a hold mode, I would say. Once everything restarts, the worry is that to just recover the losses which have, you know, which we all and the industry might have faced during this lockdown, if they start producing with double the speed, with you know, by opening up all the units which say were not even open otherwise. So we see, and we really do not want that, you know, the industries should be doing that. And to recover or to, you know, to make a thing with the economy, in case if such sectors are, they do not responsibly reopen, which they are supposed to, then we can actually see a much bigger threat to environment. So, and also, you know, the second thing which we all have been thinking is, these leopards, the elephants, and a lot of other wildlife have come in into the places where they can't see humans now. But once the lockdown is lifted, after the humans started, after the population starts moving in the areas where currently the wildlife has reclaimed, the problem of human-wildlife conflict will also increase. So, you know, we need to be watchful of clearly how these, you know, how the various threats have to be monitored, and we'll have to very closely monitor these. And I guess the responsibility on those who understand the environment, or those who are directly related to working within this sector, be it Forest Department, and, you know, be it civil society organizations, be it all those conscious citizens, the responsibility of each one of us increases, because we will have to be watchful of our surroundings, and we do not want you know, the environment to go back to what it was before lockdown. So yes, we have a huge challenge after the lockdown, and we'll have to clearly work with policymakers to find the right ways of dealing with such a catastrophe.
Thank you, ma'am, for answering this. So we have another interesting question from Surya. He says that by pursuing this course, will he be able to bring effective steps in protecting the environment?
Of course you will be. So not just by pursuing this course, Surya, if you are a responsible citizen, I'm sure you already are doing certain changes, or you might have gotten certain changes within your lifestyle. So by doing this course, what you will be in a position to do is advocate for it more. You will be in a stronger footing, I would say. You will be in with the knowledge, obviously, which you will have. You will be able to, you know, use this as a very, very effective instrument to get solutions to the problems of environment. So yes, it is, you know, by doing this course, first thing, you will understand what are the various concepts. Two, you will also clearly know how to apply them, where all, how the application of these laws and policies are possible. Then you will also know that which are the organizations, you know, who are the players within this sector who are actually making a difference, and how you can engage with them in making the difference. And, you know, I would actually suggest that you keep in touch with Anshu, and you can also speak to the alumni of this course who are already pursuing LLM. And some of them will clearly tell you that how for them this course has changed, or you know, within the career path they are already in, how they can actually see the change, and what is that they see that they can do in future. So you should be definitely interacting with our alumni.
Thank you, ma'am. So also we have another question put up by Sanyukta. She says that, what do you think if we give some kind of economic incentives for adopting environment-friendly steps and processes to industries, can help the environment in some way, because as we all know that industries are major contributors to environmental degradation.
Yes. So it is already happening, Sahita. We do have, you know, the government also, especially if you look at the operational industry, like for example, you know, someone who wants to look at alternate energy, in case if there are within industry, if there are industries who produce water filters, or you know, the AC machines, or how the consumption of power can be reduced by usage of certain machines and all. So those people who are into manufacturing of those, the incentivization to such companies is already there. The government is doing it, even the financial institutions when they give loan, like SBI or you name any bank, they do give loans, and there is a difference in case if someone is looking at environmental friendly technologies, they already are getting incentives. But the reason why we do not have that growing exponentially, which is the way we all want to, I suppose there are a lot of manufacturing which happens, which to make it available to all classes of the society. So someone who, say for example, if you know I want to have my house run completely on solar energy, solar power, so I guess I can maybe afford solar energy, say in part of my house, say outside, or you know, in my garden I can just put up these solar lamps. Then there could be some people who can afford their entire house to be completely solar. Or you know, they can actually switch to an alternate energy. So in India, anything, you know, any technology has a lot of costing attached to it, which is why the incentivization is happening, but it is not happening in the way it should be. But then that is the future. It has started happening. In few more years, the percentages, I'm sure, within WWF, we have a climate change and energy program, and they do work with industry, with the business sector. So they will have the actual reports and the figures, but it is clearly happening. There are a lot of incentivizations, and industry has also started realizing it. There are many industries, who understand and acknowledge that environment, this is the only planet, Earth is the only planet living, and we need to secure it. So that awareness is there amongst the industry too these days. It's growing.
Thank you, ma'am, for answering this. So we'll take few more questions and then we'll try to wrap up the session. So I have this another question coming up from Anu. She says that during this lockdown, there has been a lot of articles related to illegal hunting and poaching of wildlife. What is the main reason behind it, and how does this program can contribute to mitigate such illegal wildlife activities?
Oh, the program in the LLM program?
Yes, ma'am. I think that's what she's trying to, yeah.
Okay. So, the poaching in terms of why currently it's happening is, like all of us within the urban cities, poaching usually, wherever you look at closer to any of the wildlife areas, the poaching, it's not necessarily happens by those who carry the heavy gear, your guns and, saws and knives and all that. So it's not the equipment, or they are not, I'm sure, some of the understanding also comes from a lot of web series or the Hollywood movies, or even could be Bollywood movies. But the actual poaching and, the threat to wildlife also comes from the people who live very close to these areas. I'm not saying necessarily they're not from the local communities. It might not be the case. But the threat usually happens from those who actually know how and where this wildlife movement is. So if someone who's been monitoring with a specific species, and in case if they see that all around there are not many people, and with very less also forest staff who are in place, who are already stretched a lot because they're already protecting a huge area. The cases of poaching, again, as of now, we do not have a lot of cases getting recorded. There are few cases here and there happening, but again, we cannot say that it is, the poaching has actually happened. It is not rampantly like how before lockdown, I guess we used to hear more number of cases than what we are hearing after the lockdown. But again, there is exactly no evidence to say so. And in terms of how and why this can be stopped through a program like LLM, you will just know where to apply the law. Like, for example, within the National Environmental Law Specialization, which we offer, we also have sessions on illegal wildlife trade. We do teach how exactly this trade happens and what you should be watchful of. Like, for example, as a common citizen or as someone who do not know on ground how this illegal trade network runs, so for them, it will be, very difficult to understand where exactly could be the source of this problem. So what we try to obviously bust is that entire chain of illegal wildlife trade, how it happens and what are the various illegal wildlife trade starting. I mean, it could be mongoose, trade in mongoose, which is used for brushes, for making brushes, to even pangolin scales, which are used for, the concept is that it has medicinal value, or it is used for certain other food habits which other country people might have. So what you would understand by going through certain programs, or even by, in fact, going through our website, we have WWF India's website, you will see some of this, and we have Traffic India as well. So if you read some of the publications which come out of Traffic India, you would understand what is the illegal wildlife trade, how much percentage and how it is growing, and what are the solutions to curb these illegal wildlife trade problems. So this is there, but in LLM, yes, we do teach the concepts and we do tell our students about the illegal wildlife trade. And we also tell them that which law, and in case if under the Wildlife Protection Act, depending upon which schedule the wild animal falls in, the safety, the security given to that species also varies. So depending upon that, you will also know which provision to apply and to also have a solution to such problems.
Thank you, ma'am. That was really enlightening for, I think, most of us knowing about how this whole concept of poaching works. So also, I think Diksha has another question for us, and she's been contributing mm-hmm. a lot to our discussion today. Thank you, Diksha, for being a very active participant to this webinar. So she says that according to a recent announcement, the Kumbh Mela would be given a part of the Rajaji National Park. Even though it is a part of a protected area and is prohibited by the Wildlife Act and the Forest Act. And she's asking you, ma'am, what do you think it is a part of the post-lockdown strategy of not regulating the environment and giving a free hand to such activities?
Thank you, Diksha, for this question. In fact, the first, when it just came as a news alert that part of Rajaji will be given for Kumbh, my immediate reaction was, this is ridiculous. How can this happen? How can a protected area, national parks area, can be given? And then obviously, to understand, we are working in an organization which obviously also very closely works with Forest Department. And we know that, within Forest Department, there are a lot of forest officers who understand the forests in and out. They are the actual protectors, and also there are many of our field teams who work with them. So when this whole concept came, I just happened to also speak to some of the friends within the Forest Department, and they told us that, see, this is not new. For Kumbh, there was always a certain part of empty or say a barren land which is given temporarily to host or to put up the tents for the pilgrims who come. So the what I heard is that this patch, which the Forest Department has allowed, is in different. It's not a stretch of 122 or you know over 100 hectares, but it is different patches which they have given to the Kumbh Association, to those people who you know organize Kumbh every whenever it happens. So in that line, what Forest Department has done a thorough assessment of where the impact will be either zero to minimum, and only those lands have been given to Kumbh for setting up the temporary arrangement. This is the information which we have. But in my understanding, and I think that you know having lakhs and lakhs of people very close to wilderness or very close to any of the protected area, which in this case is Rajaji, will have some impact. It's not, you know, no one can rule out the negative impact which would be there on the park. But nonetheless, I guess, you know, if it is minimum or if it is completely no damage in certain areas, and if the Forest Department has done an assessment, at least 50% to say, I think 80%, we should we should think that maybe the impact would not be worse on Rajaji. And the part where actually they have given the land towards Haridwar, there I was told that there are a lot of places where the wildlife is not present as such. So I'm sure their assessment is right, and I want to believe that there will be no damage. I don't even want to buy in for a minimum damage, but I seriously want that there shouldn't be no damage to the wildlife. Anshu? Anshu, are you there? So I don't know if I'm audible to everyone. I seem to have lost Anshu.
Yeah, ma'am. Hello,
ma'am. Anshu, can you hear me? Are you there? Yeah, I can now.
Sorry, there was a network power cut at my area, so I'm sorry for that interruption. Yeah, so
this looks like earth hour.
There is another question coming. I think there is some wind coming across. The thing is that we have a next question from Mr. Mohan, who said that recently the Supreme Court has given orders to underline overhead high tension power lines in great Indian bustard habitats, and state governments like Rajasthan has not yet replied to this. How the state governments are going to work on it to implement? You can also give some updates on this case. That's what he's.
Okay, so ideally, you know, this is actually not the forum to give you the case details, but I would just acknowledge that in the Bastard case, the court has very clearly given the instructions to the state government that you should you should be adhering to, and also maybe as soon as possible have the ESZ notified. The ecologically sensitive zone, because once the ESZ is notified, then clearly it will, that notification itself will take care of a lot of these transmission lines, and it would also then give the clear instructions of what should be the height within the Great Indian Bustard habitat. So the court has asked for it. There are certain responses by the government. There are also, you know, there are certain wind energy and also which are part of within that area. There are in the identified area. So it is still going on in the court, and because the matter is sub judice, I would request you to contact on a different window, I suppose, and then yeah, we should be able to give you some information. Thank you.
Yeah. So, ma'am, we have another question from, I think, okay, that's it. So we don't have any other questions coming up for now. And I think we can, okay. So yeah, we got another question from Shyama. He says, will judicial decisions on the environment and the ground level implementation be dealt with in this course?
Sorry, I didn't get the question. Come again, Anshu. Will what?
He asked that will judicial decisions on the environment and their ground level implementation be dealt within this course?
Okay, I could partly could not hear Anshu. So from what I heard, yes, we do have a lot of cases which are, you know, especially when you are, when someone is teaching law without the precedents, without the cases, it is not possible to make the subject, you know, to make you understand the subject. So yes, a lot of environmental cases are referred to. As part of the course material also, there are many cases which we do give information about with the citations. So yes, I mean, the judicial pronouncements from past to also currently in terms of what is happening, there is a constant update. And our students, you know, sometimes, because most of all the students who enroll in the LLM program are working professionals themselves, a lot of times the interaction within the group also is very interesting, and they themselves share many cases and environmental cases and the judicial pronouncements. So yes, this course definitely deals and in fact, judicial pronouncements is one of our strengths in making the students understand the subject. Anshu, are you there? Or did we lose her again? So I think there's some problem, you know, maybe there was a power cut or something, which is why we did not. I can see she's connecting.
Thank you, ma'am, for answering this. And yeah.
Anshu, maybe you can put your video off and come on audio.
Thank you, ma'am, for this answer. And I hope you can hear me. So, ma'am, yes. I would like to, so we don't have any further questions coming up, and I would like to thank you for this amazing webinar today. We are glad to have you on board. It was really enlightening for all of the attendees. They had amazing questions and you answered them and you guided through this program. And also I would just want to, inform all the students here that if you have any doubts about our LLM program, you can find my email ID on the JGLS website, which is anshugupta@jgu.edu.in, and also my number on the website as well. For any questions or clarifications about the LLM program and the course structure, you can definitely contact me. And also I've uploaded the brochure on through this webinar, so whoever wants to access it can definitely access it through this. So thank you everyone for this. Thank you for joining us. It was amazing to have you all on board. And I would also like to thank Mrs. Malika Arabi for coming today and giving us this, you know, amazing lecture. Ma'am, do you have anything to end with for the attendees here?
Yes, definitely. You know, a big thank you, because during these times, which definitely is not someone expected, and we are all going through our set of problems by being just locked down. Some are happy because they are able to invent, or you know, this is an opportunity they are taking to understand what they are good at and what they want to do. So take this as an opportunity. Each one of you stay safe, because that's what is the most important thing which should be there on everyone's mind. And acknowledge also, you know, follow what the government is saying, because you are the ones who have been asking about policies and law. So be those law-abiding citizens. And thanks a lot for joining. All the very best to everyone, and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for coming over. And also, thank you, everyone. Stay safe, stay home. All the best. Bye-bye.